Okay, so this has nothing to do with anything, but right now, as you can see, Back to the Future Part 2 is playing in my hotel room on TNT, but it's on the voice-assisted thing for the blind, if you can hear it. Hang on.
Griff's crew hops on their hoverboards and glides down the street beside the park. Marty jumps on his board and speeds through the park onto the street as a rocket-powered Jeep with camouflage paint flies down and lands.
I don't know how to turn this off on my remote, and I don't want to. This is amazing.
The Jeep speeds off past Griff's cohorts. Dad and the others turn around and follow the Jeep. Biff watches the action with a furrowed brow.
It's like watching a movie with a robot. I thought it'd be best if I shoot this intro tonight, since I have no idea how much time I'll have in the morning, but right now I am staying at a Ramada in Anaheim because I want to be at the park that much brighter and earlier tomorrow. Because tomorrow, for the first time ever, I will experience the two new attractions DCA is opening this summer, Frozen Live at the Hyperion and Soarin' Around the World. Frozen, of course, is replacing the Aladdin show that used to be at the Hyperion, and it's also, in its weird way, replacing the Frozen sing-along show that replaced Muppet Vision.
So the Muppet Vision Theater is now the Sunset Showcase Theater. Damn you, Tex Richmond. Oh, it's now showing an exclusive sneak peek of...
Nothing! Absolutely nothing! Stupid! You're so stupid!
And of course, Soarin' Around the World. Okay, remember in my Guardians vlog when I said that it was a good idea, if you're gonna replace something popular, to only do it on one coast at a time? Well, they're not doing that with Soarin' Around the World. For those who don't know, a bit of history. When DCA opened in 2001, Soarin' Over California was, in many people's opinions, the only thing that unequivocally worked about that park. It was pretty much the best thing there. 4 years later, a clone of it opened at Epcot, and it very quickly became the most popular ride there, as I mentioned in my 30 years of Epcot video. But it was never a great fit, because Soarin' Over California, which had its name shortened to Soarin' for Epcot, like the title implies, was Soarin' Over various landmarks in California, and that made perfect sense for Disney's California Adventure. It was pretty much the only thing there that really justified the idea of doing a California park. But at Epcot, it didn't really make that much sense, and for years there was a rumor that Epcot would shoot a new film called Soarin' Around the World, which would take you to various locations all around the world, which would tie in much better to World Showcase. Well, now that's finally opening in both parks. In Disney California Adventure, they got rid of Soarin' Over California, and now they've replaced it with Soarin' Around the World. Now, I know the name Disney California Adventure is pretty much just a decorative title at this point. They've really given up on the idea of it being a California-based theme park. They got rid of Golden Dreams and Bountiful Valley Farm and a lot of the other stuff that was very directly related to California.
I think it has something to do with California.
But it still just doesn't make that much sense to not open it at Epcot. This had better be, like, the best ride ever. I really hope they didn't ruin it. I hope they didn't screw it up. But time will tell. Frozen Fast Passes sell out very quickly, so I'm getting to the park bright and early tomorrow. VidCon just ended today, so we got some people in town for that. We're gonna have a whole bunch of people. I don't know how many are gonna be able to join me for the vlog to offer their opinions, but should be fun. The park opens in 9 hours, so I'd better get some sleep, and I'll see you tomorrow.
Line just to get fast passes for Frozen. They didn't even bother to put up ropes. They just put some tape on the ground. Disney magic, everybody.
We are about to see Frozen live at the Hyperion, the theater that doesn't need a lobby, apparently. What do you expect from this show, Mikey?
I expect them to sing.
Morgan?
Air conditioning.
Seating. Hot babes. I'm expecting it will be very unlike the 2011 horror movie, no, that was also called Frozen.
I think there will be frozen fractals all around, not just in a concentrated area in front of you, but behind you, to the sides, in the ceiling, all around.
Well, they're going to freeze us in carbonite. This is all just a trap, obviously.
It's a tourist trap.
Yeah! Boom, ba-boom!
Actually, since it's a musical, it's a Von Trapp.
Yeah! Boom, ba-boom!
I don't have a pun, so just move on.
Yeah!
boom, ba boom.
I don't get it.
Yeah! Boom, ba boom.
This is getting obnoxious.
Yeah! Yes, it is.
I like turtles.
Yeah!
I do.
Me and the snowman and me.
All right, we just saw Frozen live at the Hyperion, and it's pretty good.
I enjoyed that.
Yeah.
I dig it. As far as, like, I mean, it was...
As an abbreviated recap of the movie.
Yeah. It made very good decisions of what to cut. Like, it cut a lot of sort of extraneous stuff in the second act. It cut the ice monster, because I don't know how you would
monster,
do that in,
it
on
cut,
stage.
The ice effects are kind of what you're expecting they're going to be. They're just, like, lights on the stage.
Yeah.
Cutting the ice monster was my one disappointment. Not necessarily from a narrative standpoint, right. Just because I wanted to see how they would do it.
But
they didn't. A lot of the limitations of the show are just kind of limitations that come with the limitations of theater compared to animation.
Yeah.
Like, for example, I know Anna was a lot more, I guess, wacky in this one, you might say. Maybe it was just the actress we saw play Anna, but she was much more of a spaz in this one.
Yeah.
And she's
always been something.
Playing to
spaz.
The cheap seats.
The actress who played Anna in particular kept doing this thing that bothered me, where she would like take the already like over enunciation that actors will do because that is a thing you were taught in theater.
Yep.
And then would make it even worse. Like, especially
she Malkovich'd it.
She any word that ended with T, she, like, whether she was singing or talking, she'd be like, "We are out of here right now."
I am Princess Anna of Arendelle, and I want you to take me up the North Mountain.
It was just one weird thing that every time she did, I went, "What?"
What did you guys think of like the digital backdrops for sets?
I thought that worked really well.
I like that.
It looked like Soarin for a lot of it.
Soarin over Arendelle.
It worked. I thought because they let it go past the set.
Because they let it go.
Oh, you said the thing.
Everyone take a shot.
Fired. I love the way they did Sven. A reindeer with a disembodied head on its back.
Try me, bitch.
Well,
I'm a reindeer
like
murders.
Like a camel hump with a human face.
Exactly.
And he has that look that says, yes, just go with it.
Well, it's the same it's the same thing they do in Avenue Q.
Right.
And that have major puppet characters.
Which is appropriate, Bobby Lopez.
Yeah, and it's the same thing as Pumbaa from Lion King, too. So.
Right, exactly. Like, and it's, I mean, the puppet is there. But you can also look at the actor's face for the emoting
and,
if you're having a hard time reading the puppet.
And even more so with Olaf.
See, Olaf is unfortunate because the head is right here and you've got a giant carrot sticking out of it.
Yeah.
It's just unfortunate placement for that. And then when the reindeer bites it off, you're just like, ah!
The one thing they added that I thought was really interesting was a reprise at the end.
Of Love is an Open Door.
Of Love is an Open Door.
Yeah.
Now, one of the big things with, you know, the crappy sing-along show they used to have over here is it ends with a reprise of Let It Go, because that's the big popular song.
Yeah.
Even though, narratively, that song is all about her running away from her problems
and
not facing it head-on.
Yeah.
Like, it's not a reprise song, it just happened to be the big hit. And I was dreading that there'd be a nonsensical reprise of Let It Go in this show. And the song I always thought deserved a reprise at the end of the movie was Do You Want to Build a Snowman, with Elsa singing it to Anna to, like, bring that full circle.
Yeah, that would have been good.
But Love is an Open Door surprised me in the way they actually recontextualized the song to be about an actual genuine love.
And the parents showed up again in the Statler and Waldorf balcony.
Sort of like the ghost parents.
You have no business singing this song.
Yeah.
You were the reason they didn't have open doors or love.
See what good children we didn't raise?
Yes, this was our solution to the problem.
Lock her up by herself for her entire life and teach her to be afraid of everything.
What
there's
I would love
no
is if they,
way
like,
it
properly
could backfire.
Made them ghosts, and you just have, and they're just like soaking wet. And there's seaweed on them.
we could have had them fly in on the flying carpet rig. Like, yay!
You compare this to the Aladdin show. And they're both very theatrical in opposite ways, whereas the Aladdin show took a lot more liberties with the script of the movie, and both in terms of the genie's improv, but also just in terms of, like, re-catering the story to a stage show.
There's no blue people, you know, making delightful one-liners about the Kardashians in this show, so there's that.
The theatricality of the Aladdin show was more about being in the moment, more about, like, letting the actors take liberties and, like, really presenting live. The theatricality of this show was more about just the spectacle, the visual effects, the set design.
And the choreography was really, really good, too.
Yeah.
Although there was that weird moment, I don't know if this happened when you saw it, but the sled effect didn't work.
The sled broke during the show.
The sled broke.
Oh, really?
And the theater went black, and their announcer said, "Ladies and gentlemen, due to unforeseen circumstances, we are delayed. Please have patience.
Goddamn playful spooks."
And then finally, "Thank you for your patience. We now resume our show." And it's the scene after they've just jumped the gorge, and Christoph just said, "Oh, I blacked out there for a minute."
I think, I kind of liked the line before the blackout where they're just like, where Christoph's just like, "This is a really long jump."
There wasn't that much audience participation in this, or at least not much interaction, not much people, you know, going down the aisles.
Yeah, not like the Aladdin show had that.
Yeah,
parade.
The Aladdin show had the Prince Ali scene, which was.
This one had the funeral procession.
Yes.
That's one thing I miss about the Aladdin show was the Holy World scene where they were literally above your head.
That was nice. So here they got the giant snowflake, and that's about it.
They got the Phantom of the Opera chandelier.
They got the giant snowflake and they got the stairs that you can walk up.
Oh yeah, the spinning staircase on loan from Hogwarts.
All I asked for was a frickin' rotating stair.
The whole transformation during the Let It Go song, that was the part I was looking forward to the most of seeing. She did the quick change from the outfit she was wearing. The lights went black for just half a second. She pulled the ripcord, and then her dress transformed into the Elsa dress. Man, they got that perfect. That was so cool.
They did. And
also, she takes off the cape, and there's like a wire attached to it that made
that
it
just fly away.
Definitely an upgrade compared to the Aladdin show. Whether or not I'd recommend it really depends on how much time you have in the park.
Yeah.
It didn't bring much that was new. It was more of like a translation rather than an adaptation.
You gotta, get in line for it like an hour or at least half an hour before it starts. And then the show itself is like an hour and 10 minutes or something. And so it's a pretty long commitment. If you've only got like one day in the park, I don't recommend it. But if you've got several days, give it a shot.
Well, it also depends on how much you like the movie.
If you're obsessed with Frozen and just love the movie and want to see it represented here, this is a good representation. Better than the sing-along, certainly.
Probably like that little kid who was right behind us who had a Frozen outfit on.
Yes.
This is the movie. This is the thing for her.
Now, after this cut, we shall see how we feel about Soarin' Around the World. Woo! Magic. The camera's flying away!
Well, here we are, about to ride Soarin' over not just California.
Is it Patrick Warburton? Real disappointment.
I will be very sad if Patrick Warburton is not still in this ride.
I want Patrick Warburton's part to be extended. Now he has to be flying in front of me the entire time.
No glider, just him flying like Superman.
Yeah, it's amazing how much you miss at super speed.
Now, what I'm expecting from this ride is one that is a lot more Soarin'.
See, I'm looking forward to us getting that ring to Mordor so that Soarin' can't get his hands on it.
You have my camera.
Do I have your love?
No.
Oh. Am I supposed to do a Patrick Warburton impression?
Sure.
Hi, I'm Patrick Warburton.
That was amazing.
You may know me from that TV show Game Over that only 5 people watched.
They're traveling by map. I thought it was just a non-stop to Cincinnati. I didn't know.
For a direct flight.
The pilot is lost and he won't ask for directions. They will see us waving from so much
great heights come down. Yeah! Patrick! All right, all 12 of us have just ridden Soarin' Around the World. Okay, so general opinions, general consensus here?
Actually, I like it more than Soarin' Over California. I like it more.
It's so magical.
It's very pretty. Soarin' will always be nostalgic over California for me, but that was really good.
I liked it.
I viscerally liked it a lot. There are a couple of things I had more complex thoughts about, but we'll get to those after everyone else gets their general thoughts.
Yeah, I thought it was an improvement over the original.
It was definitely a spectacle. I'll give it that much. There were moments that were literally breathtaking. The Eiffel Tower was amazing. Literally, Chris and I both shouted Vive la France at the same time.
I heard that, yeah. Aside from just the expanded location, the key difference between this ride and the original ride is the addition of transitions.
Yeah. Those are those.
And in theory, I liked that, and in practice, I liked some of them, but some of them were really fake-looking.
There were really clever touches in this, like how the top of the Taj Mahal match-dissolved into a hot air balloon.
I liked that transition.
Honestly, the transitions are the thing that makes me the happiest, because just the hard cuts all the time in the last one drove my editor brain insane.
I never minded the jump cuts in the original because they fit the rhythm of the music so well, which I do have to talk about the music. It's basically a new arrangement of the classic themes. It's like the big epic reprise at the end of the opera or something. I think it works.
It incorporated more like world music, it used a sitar during the Taj Mahal segment. I appreciated that.
It was basically just the original, but bigger. It was like everything was bigger.
Every detail of this was just Soarin, but bigger.
There were moments when it seemed a bit much, in particularly in the CGI department.
CGI animals were extremely conspicuous.
Yeah.
Most of the animals I didn't think looked all that right, except for the killer whale, and that was one of my favorite transitions.
We're getting a lot closer to the locations than we generally got in the original Soarin' Over California, which again was all real in camera flying.
Except for the golf ball and Tinkerbell.
This does get you up close and personal, again, with the bigger, grander thing. Like, you get up really close, you don't fly over the Eiffel Tower, you get up close to the Eiffel Tower, and that's fine, and it's immersive in that way, but it doesn't feel as real as the original. Like, even with the transitions, the original Soarin' Over California felt more real to me because it actually felt like the angle you'd actually be getting if you were flying over these places.
Well, plus no CGI animals in the original.
Elements are happening at exactly the right time. The polar bear jumps in the water, the killer whale jumps out of the water. Yeah, and the CGI was really conspicuous before, but there was so little of it, it didn't draw attention.
Well, they tried to train their own killer whale, but there's been some backlash against that lately.
So we go to the North Pole, and we see the polar ice caps melting and breaking off, and that's supposed to send a message about global warming, I suppose, but if you see all these obviously CGI polar bears and the orca whale and all that, if someone doesn't believe in global warming still, isn't the obvious fakeness just not gonna...
Well, obviously they added the CGI of the glaciers. Global warming ain't real.
There was always something to look at. The old California version I loved, but some points you would be like, I'm looking at land. But every time you go somewhere here, you're looking at something big and grand.
I do like the scents they used this time.
That's true. The smells are better.
They used grass for Kilimanjaro, they used jasmine for the Taj Mahal, and they used coconut for Fiji.
Once we got up close and personal with those elephants, I wasn't getting just pure elephant
dung. Pure barnyard.
Yeah, pure elephant dung. Yeah, that was all I wanted.
The Great Wall of China, I felt like more thrilling than any other time I've been on Soarin.
Probably the fastest Soarin's ever gone.
The Great Wall of China, just because I'm like, oh my goodness, a person that's not CGI.
I think they also staged the canoeing thing all outside of Fiji as well.
You go from, I think it's Fiji, to this waterfall area, and you see the falls going over this cliff, and right when you go over it, you feel... Oh. And it's just like, at that one moment, you're like... No, I'm fucking flying. I was actually kind of upset there wasn't an actual Yeti on Matterhorn. It was like, for corporate synergy, really.
Put the fireworks over the real German castle.
Disneyland is no longer Christmas.
Yes, it's not a Christmas parade. It's actually people there to watch the fireworks.
It's a non-Christmas miracle. When Jack was here, we were shooting the Haunted Mansion, and we went on Soarin', and when it got to the Disneyland end scene, he was like, it's Inception! Damn you, Leo!
Why didn't they fly us over the real Neverland?
Anyone else?
This new version of the ride is perfect for Epcot.
Yes.
Because this really is, it's like Disney World versus Disneyland, how that's, Disneyland, but bigger and grander and more overwhelming. This is Soarin', but bigger and grander and more overwhelming.
I'm going to be the jerk who says I miss the California pride of the old ride movie. I'm enough of a home state girl that I was really, I always got a thrill seeing the Golden Gate Bridge. I always got a thrill with the San Diego Harbor flyover. I mean, it was just so cool.
And the thing is, because the original Soarin' Over California was the one thing about DCA 1.0 that worked, it's sad to just completely let go of that now.
I will say,
That 4K looks really nice.
The original one, it was off, obviously filmed on a lower frame rate. And with the upgrade that it had a while ago, you could tell it looked brighter and better.
Yeah.
But it also kind of had that 2001 quality in it still.
You're showing it to
this me. One was put with the whole digital projection in mind. I just felt more enveloped in this thing, like I was seeing something happening at every time.
Patrick Warburton's still there.
They didn't shoot a new pre-show. They just used the old one from Epcot where he just says Soarin.
The reality of the original version felt immersive to me in a different way than this one feels immersive, is really what it comes down to.
How many of you come to Disneyland to get real stuff?
That's fair, but...
Well, again, perfect for Epcot. This one was definitely much more fantastical, where the original had much more of a documentary feel to it. But maybe, you know, in a sense, maybe the more fantastical element does fit better in Disneyland as opposed to Epcot.
I think it would fit in Disneyland Park. I don't think it fits as well in California Adventure Park. That said, California Adventure was never a great theme for a park, so... Sure. Maybe this is just too good for this place.
We're talking about this shouldn't be fantastical while we're down the street from giant bug land.
We're not saying it shouldn't be fantastical. We're just making the observation.
I'm not saying I dislike the fantastical element. I'm just saying there was something I appreciated about the realism of the original.
Yeah.
Although it was lacking a hefty helping of a bunch of yellow characters. Because as we all know, an Omnimax screen has to have the Simpsons.
Why is this ride as popular as it is? Because from my point of view, comparing it to something like Back to the Future / The Simpsons, that's like a neat experience where it's an adventure and there's literally things happening to you and there's a plot line that you're supposedly directly involved in. Here it's like, I'm going to sit on a swingy chair, look at the pretty pictures, and have smells blown at me. And there's a 75-minute wait for this.
Well,
why is this so popular?
This one is new. Simpsons Ride has the same kind of Omnimax simulator technology. But this is that rare breed. It's a thrill ride that actually soothes you.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't. It actually lowers
it's a
your anxiety.
Chill ride.
It's a chill ride. Exactly.
It's like comparing a documentary film to a video game.
It's
pretty much.
It's all about the wonder of flying, and that's what the queue is all about. It's supposed to get you feeling like what it would be like to have wings and just see all of those things from the air.
And the fun thing is, especially, particularly the original. Soarin' Over California, is it takes that wonder of flying and takes it to places you have probably been as a Californian.
Yeah.
And places that you know about, and you recontextualize it through that wonder, and suddenly your road trip from when you were 12 becomes that adventure.
I went on the Soarin' Over California, Florida version like 8 or 9 years ago. I have very little memory of it, so this is basically like a whole brand new thing, and all of my travels have really only been on the East Coast, so I don't have that sort. So that's why I kind of like this better. Like, I would rather see new places than, you know, fly over Fenway Park.
It's basically the same song, just different verses. You can quibble about which one is better till the cows come home, but at the end of the day, it is still Soarin', and it still comes with a high recommendation for that alone. Me personally, I think I still prefer the original just a little bit, but hey, this is still pretty cool, and I'm sure I'll get used to it.
Do you prefer the Soarin' Over California over Soarin' Around the World because
it's a small world?
I go to conventions dressed up as a three-part snowman with a carrot in my face.
If you're, you know, from Scandinavia, you were just Bjorn that way.
Really?
And scene.
Frosty the snowman was a snowman in the snow. And he had a big old pickup truck and a dog.